All right. Hey, welcome to the Go for CEO channel. My name is John the Bomb. Building Others Means Business, Andrade, and I am your host and so excited to have yet another CEO, founder, entrepreneur, someone that is killing it in their game. This lady has a lot of notoriety, a lot of media behind her, and doing some big, big things. And excited because once again, you know, I'm building these incredible relationships on Clubhouse, this new social audio app, and it gets me closer to people like Heather Ann Havenswood, the boss of Sexy Boss Inc. So, Heather, thank you so much for coming on the Go for CEO channel. How are you?
I'm awesome. Thanks for having me. I'm super excited about this. It's so funny. Whenever I do an interview, and I've done over 450 this time, I always want, you know, it's weird when people talk about you, you're like, who's that cool person? Oh, that's me. You know, because as an entrepreneur, I never really look back and go, what have I created? I'm constantly in that vision of go, go, go. So thank you for the accolades. Thank you for that. And what's so fascinating about Clubhouse is that you can really build quickly a relationship so fast, like speeds up the relationship so much. So super excited to have, be here.
Well, you know, what you instantly notice is someone that's BSing you or someone that's for real, right? So I think that's the beauty of Clubhouse is, you know, people ask questions on Clubhouse and all of a sudden you can find out, like, if they answer it in a weird way, you're like, does this person really know? But I will say, I mean, just to give you kudos from just even the last room I was in that you were leading, I mean, you just dropped some incredible nuggets. I know another gal that we both know, Angela, we were like texting in the background, like, oh my God, that's so awesome. What a cool thing. So really excited to have you on. So typically, Heather, we'd like to start with, you know, kind of your background, a little bit about where you came from and what, you know, what made you think of Sexy Boss Inc. and how you started it. So why don't you tell us a little bit about you and then we'll kind of go with the next steps.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I want to go all the way back, but I do want to go back to the fact that I started in the corporate world many, many, many moons ago. And I was very successful in the corporate world in sales, like a high-end sales. What's so fascinating about that story, and I'm more than happy to go into it further, but I actually got fired for being successful. And I was number one in the country of 10,000 reps at a telecom company. And after I got my, what I call pat on the head, because I was hoping for like a Rolex, you know, they basically fired me. And it was like this huge, like slap in the face of like, wait, you know, my whole life I was taught go to school, go to college and then work for the company. And that's it, you know? And so that was my big like slap of like, okay, corporate world or reality of business is not what I thought it was. I was super young. I was only 25. And that kind of speared me into entrepreneur land. And the reason why I share that is because a lot of people talk about how they so want to own their own business. I didn't want to. Like I was corporate. I was being successful. I was pushed out of corporate, right? I was pushed out. Like, you don't belong here, literally. And so in the world of entrepreneurship, I kind of come a belief that people either born entrepreneurs or leaders or they're not. Sometimes you can grow them, but I have that belief because I kind of am that person. One time in my life, 10 years later, I went back to corporate world. I lasted 3 months and my boss, two of my bosses walked in and said, we like you. You're awesome. You've hit your quota. We have no problems with you. You're an entrepreneur. We're firing you, literally. And so the reason I share that with you is because who I really am as an entrepreneur, I've built 5 different businesses from newsletter businesses, supplement, weight loss, information marketing and everything in between. And so I'm here now, like my big thing now, I'm 46 years old. I'm here now too with one mission. And my mission is to help a million, for me, it's women, million women to truly start and grow their business, no matter where they're at in the world, no matter their demographic, their age, or their background. So that's my mission in life, but I've definitely been building businesses since 2001. My very first dollar was made in 2001. My first million online was in 2005. My first bankruptcy was 2006. So, and I've built multi-million dollar businesses since then. And that, I think I share that kind of roller coaster with you, mainly because I want people to realize that you might see these accolades I have now in books and awards, but it hasn't been a linear path and it hasn't been straight. it's been a lot of ups and downs and mountains along the way. So just want to kind of give you an overview. But in the world of what's going on now, you know, I was just named by 2020 by Stevie Award, the most innovative woman of the year in social media. You know, that was nice. And then 2017 was named by Huffington Post top female entrepreneur to watch. I say all that and it's great. And I love the awards and been on a lot of shows, but what is it all about? What is entrepreneurship about? What is being a CEO about? It's about building, creating, and helping and serving the world.
I love it. I love it. You know, and you went through that journey with us, and I thank you for that. So the last, you know, minute and a half or two really just showcases someone that's real, right? You said it, you know, you were what's called an intrapreneur. You were at the entrepreneur mindset inside of a corporation, kicking ass. And then all of a sudden, you know, hey, things happen. Then when you went back for one stint, they told you, no, please go back to being an entrepreneur.
They literally fired me again. Yeah, it was pretty funny.
It's funny. So, but look, what an incredible journey. And thank you for sharing that. And I think that one of the things with the Go for CEO channel is we try to teach people, like, what is it that you're doing? Like, I was always curious when I was younger, like, hey, you know, this director of whoever or CEO of this company, what do they actually do on a daily basis? So why don't we start there? You know, obviously you started the business many moons ago. You've had some ups and downs, recently some incredible accolades. So tell us a little bit of perspective of kind of your day-to-day, and then we'll get into marketing and some other areas of your business.
So I follow something called the wealth dynamics. It's by Roger Hamilton. I studied him. And the reason why I bring that up is because when you ask me on a daily basis, like, what is my job duty and responsibility? My main job duty and responsibility every single day is marketing and getting my message out there and my message and my market out there. Like, that's my number one goal every single day. If I'm not marketing my business, no one else will. I think a lot of people want to put off sales and marketing. They want to put that off. They want to just be the hot head show and they want to do operations. That to me is not an entrepreneur. And that might sound critical, but I just believe that. I look at Grant Cardone and some people, JT Fox. I look at some really big people. At the end of the day, the job doing responsibility of a CEO, I believe, is marketing number one and sales. Right. And the moment you try to put that off on someone, especially if you're the creator, it just fails. So like Steve Jobs, if you look at Mark Zuckerberg, if you look at Jeff Bezos, do they have big teams at this point that do sales and things like that? Obviously, Steve Jobs is no longer with us. But when he started, yes, but it was still his job doing responsibility to stay the visionary of the message. So that's what I do every single day. And then the operations and things like that, those do get done. But honestly, I feel like it's the responsibility. And I kind of go back to a story a friend of mine always said. They're like, you know, if you look at an athlete, right, the Olympics and what's been going on, an athlete, you know, no one can do the job of an athlete. The job of an athlete is to play, is to get on the court or to, you know, to get on the, you know, whatever playing field there is, to get in the pool. It's to play. That's the job. Everything else is just minutiae around it. But if they're not on the field playing, then they're not in the game. And entrepreneurs don't, in my experience, a lot of entrepreneurs don't want to get hit. The hit is stuff coming at you every day, right? Financial issues, loans, clients, they don't want to get hit. And this is what I say to that. I come from Texas, so I'm a football fan. I'm a Cowboy fan. And in peewee football, the first thing they teach little kids, little boys in the world of football, they teach them how to get hit, right? How to actually get hit without getting hurt. That's entrepreneurship. You will get hit. If you don't know how to take a punch or take a hit in business, don't get in the game, like literally, because that's part of it. Sometimes you get a huge run. But most of the time it's tackling and being tackled and trying to get that ball down the field 5 or 10 yards at a time. That's what an entrepreneur is about. And I don't think it's for everyone, but my daily focus every day to answer your question is marketing and sales, period.
I love it. You know, that perspective is so deep because, you know, yeah, everybody thinks, hey, you know, oh, I saw an advertisement that said I can make 10K a month in 30 days. And I can do this and I can do that, but nobody remembers that the work that it takes to get into it, right? And building a YouTube channel, building the products and services that you've been able to do. It's incredible stuff. So tell us a little bit about, like, hey, when, you know, you create Sexy Boss Inc., which is a really cool name. It's kind of the brand that you're out there on there, right? And it's just this aura that you have around you. So what are some of the beginning things that you would say to a beginning entrepreneur? I know that you said, hey, you're laser focused on a daily basis with what you just talked about. But what are some things that maybe at the beginning, take us back a little bit of kind of the creation of Sexy Boss Inc. What were some developing areas that you wanted to really concentrate on? And how did you start to create revenue?
So a couple things. Number one is be super clear on who your market is. And Sexy Boss is females. And of course, I work with men when it would appropriate. I'm not against men, but it's about also understanding my market and what I chose, right? So sometimes people have a hard time with that. Like, but I want to help everybody. That's number one, is being super clear on your market and being okay with that, right? Just completely owning that, loving that, and being completely okay with that. Number two is being clear on your offering. And in the world of information marketing, which is kind of my lane, I'm not really into product marketing, using physical products. I've had businesses in that, but it's just not my everyday thing. My main focus is, how do you take your knowledge and turn it into something that's a product? And there's three phases of that. And people try to jump phases. That's because they see, you know, ads and things like that. The phase one is always one-to-one. One-to-one on clients, could be coaching, could be consulting, whatever that is, but it's a one-to-one. It's belly-to-belly, as we old call sales, right? And old school sales talk is like belly-to-belly, because that's where you learn the pain points and what people need, desire, and want. Then from there in phase two, you can move to what I call one-to-many. Could be evergreen courses. It could be a group coaching program. It could be a membership site, but it's a one-to-many. But by that time, you're clear on your avatar. You're clear on what you provide, and you're clear that you're providing it in such a way that people are making results. And then that third and the ultimate tier, right, is evergreen, where you have ads that go to courses. You sleep on your, you know, sleep, you do nothing kind of thing. It's not the truth, but you get the point. And things are working without you. It's automated. And you go into higher ticket, big higher ticket things. Those, I think, if you look at it from an evolution perspective, in my brain, because I'm very visual, I see like a monkey is like their first level. And then like the mid-level is what I call like caveman, right? And then third level is like where we're at now in 2021, we're going to the moon and stuff. If you understand that business is a process, it's not a leap, I think it's really important. I think one of the it's a bad thing and good thing. I mean, like people like Elon Musk and Steve Jobs and Mark Zuckerberg are amazing, Jeff Bezos, but everyone looks at them where they're at now. They don't look at where they really started, right? And I love the picture. I have no idea if it's even false. They said it's Photoshopped, but it doesn't matter. There's a picture of Jeff Bezos by himself with like a banner that says Amazon on it. He's by himself. It's probably true. Who knows? Who cares? But it does say everything, right? That's where he started and he stayed in that vision. And people look at Zuckerberg and how brilliant he is, and they just think, oh, they just do some coding, everything's going to work out. The challenge with that is that people don't understand the progression. And business is a progression, just like marriage, right? You don't go from date one to married the next day and everything's great. It really is a progression. A lot of people don't want to take it on as that. So with all that said, when I do work with people at the very beginning, I tell them you have to start with one-on-one. It might be painful. You might hate it, whatever. You might enjoy one-on-one, but that's got to be the crux, because then you can really feel where your client is and who they are. And that goes back to like Jack Welch, you know, Good to Great, how he used to go in and actually be with the people at GE and the workers. I mean, obviously it was a big company, but he had to get into the ground level to see the belly to belly of what was really going on so that he could go back to the executive suite to grow. So it goes back to that, you know, so that's what I say.
I love it that, you know, you went through kind of the evolution of how to think, right? Start to finish. And then in your specific business and industry, 1, 2, 3. So ladies and gentlemen, the Go for CEO channel is really about that, right? I know you mentioned Zuck and some of the big names, but look, I mean, it's Heather Ann Havenwood, right? It's Sexy Boss Inc. It's this person that is doing millions of dollars in business, but But, you know, besides the incredible accolades, it's someone teaching you how a real business gets done, especially in her industry. So structurally right now, what's kind of the dynamic of your enterprise at the moment?
So right now I have a couple of workshops. I have an upcoming event. It's called the Influencer Intensive, and I help people create their podcasts, like what we're doing right now. And the reason why I'm helping them create the podcast is what's so fascinating about a show or a podcast is that it forces people to figure out the target market, what is their name and brand, how they're going to position themselves in the marketplace, and then putting art to that, and then putting it out there in the world, like on Spotify, iHeart, Pandora, Deezer, Savannah, Ghana, and 22 networks. So in 3 days, people put their whole message out there on 22 networks around the world. And every single time I do this workshop, people go, oh my God, it's like this transformational process. Because there's one thing about sitting at home, John, you know, with an idea, like, you know, hanging out by yourself, maybe telling your friends or family or loved one. But there's a whole nother thing when you put it out there and it's like, oh my God, that's all over the world. You know, it's like, it's real. And so it forces people through that process and that transformation process. And then every time 100% of the clients come through there and they now are clear on their business. So it's almost as if creating the show helps them create the business. And then I work with them for a year, creating their products and services. What does that look like? What does their one-to-one packages look like, group, and then moving on? So that's what I'm doing now. And I have something called the Influencer Academy, Influencer Tribe. And that's what I work with people on now. So it's super awesome and super fun.
I love it. And of course, I mean, you know, you started this with an idea. You get kicked out of corporate America. You take that as a hell yeah, let's go make it happen entrepreneurship wise. So tell us a little bit about that's your current scenario of what you're helping people with, a little bit of the dynamic of like your enterprise. So obviously as the CEO, do you work with independent contractors? Do you bring in vendors? How does that work kind of to really mix in the way that you do business?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I knew you're going to ask that question and I had to think about it. I'm 100% freelancers. Almost every single person's a freelancer. And when I was in my transition, I had to start to figure out because freelancers are interesting. You don't own them, you know, like they're not an employee. So you can't really tell them like here at 9 o'clock at 9 a.m. You can request, are you available at 9 a.m.? You know, you have to treat them like a client / respect that for their own business. You know, so one of the things I really do a lot of with my freelancers is I spend time getting to know them. Like I just messaged one of my freelancers, he's going through something personal in his private life. And I just checked in, like, how are you? Like, what's going on? Are you okay? And he's like, yeah, here's what's happening. I was like, cool. And by the way, if you could do this for me, that'd be awesome when you get around to it, you know, whatever. And he said, great. So when people can respect that, they really appreciate it. Cause I clear they have 10 or 15 clients or whatever their business is. That's different for people who come from corporate, who try to move into entrepreneurship. They're used to controlling, like, you know, be here. This is, I own you. It's a very different social dynamic. And I will say for my, this is back in 13 or 14. I went back to corporate America for 5 minutes, my 3 months, my third 90 days of like going back. I'll never forget the guy that I worked for, or I guess he was my boss. It's so weird to say that. And I said, why is it you guys are making salespeople be here at 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. every Friday? And they forced us to be at the office. Right, no matter what your sales were or your numbers or your success, they forced you to be there 4 to 5 p.m. on a Friday. It was crazy. I go, that's like the worst thing you could ever do to a salesperson. He goes, we do that because we own you, your salary, you know, we own you. And that was like this aha. I'm like, I gotta get out of here, you know. So it is like that though. It's the golden handcuffs, as they call it. I only lasted 90 days and he kicked me out, and in a loving way, by the way. It was kind of hilarious because my boss's boss actually called me 6 months later and said, I'm going to start a business. Can you consult me? It's quite hilarious, actually. But my point of that is, in the world of employees, you can't treat them like that. I mean, salespeople are all about like production so we can have freedom. Forcing a salesperson to come to the office at 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. physically, can't do the meeting virtually at all, or you'll be fired. Like stupid stuff like that. It's almost to me, it's like crazy. I'm one of those people where it's all about freedom and flow, structures, timelines, and you know, here's what I need, here's what I need to buy. Can you do it? And just making requests. It's a very different kind of lifestyle versus an employee, which you can have a different kind of dynamic with them. And I don't think a lot of people, especially in the entrepreneurial world, take the time to figure that out. Because at the end of the day, the freelancer can say no to you, you know? They can say no to you, like, I don't want to work with you. And they have every right to do that. Copywriters are very unique in how they work. So most copywriters, I'm just speaking this for people who are listening, a really good copywriter is really sometimes challenging to work with. They're creators. So they go into what this call is, I call it the mode. So they'll listen and they dive deep into their work and then they like come out. So they'll like disappear for days at a time or weeks at a time or something crazy. And then they'll like come out of the woodwork or something. That's a creative, that's a hardcore creative. So when you try to treat them like a 9-to-5er, it'll never work. You know what I mean? You have to give them flow. So I do freelancers just because I understand them. I know how to communicate them and I don't like to have employee tax.
No, hey, I mean, that's an incredible thing, right? You just went through a nice masterclass of how to really influence those people that aren't under your direct attention, right? Or subordination per se, right? Yeah. As you said, right, in management, you know, you could call it leadership, which is a better word, but management is about kind of putting the thumb on like, hey, you got to do this, this, and this. Where leadership, it could be worked in the entrepreneur spirit or in the corporate world if you do it right, because leadership then is about you putting in the work and also showing them and then being emotionally intelligent to, like you said, right? You know that they're in the weeds, like leave them alone. They know that August 19th is the deadline, but right, you don't need to bother them on August 12th, right? So pretty awesome stuff. Pretty awesome stuff.
Like just another freelancer, something I guess people are going through stuff right now. One of them has been in the hospital. He had COVID. He's still there. And, you know, I've been checking in on him, you know, and then finally he's still there, but he's like, okay, I'm just sitting here, I'm bored. Do you have work? So now I'm like giving him work. I'm like, are you sure? And checking in on him still, you know, but he's like, hey, I'm just sitting here. Like, I can't really do anything. I can't really move. So I might as well do some work for you. But I mean, but that's because I've been checking on him for 2 weeks. You know, how are you? How's your family? What's going on? Are you okay? We've been sitting in blessings. I've been sending little videos of just like, we love you and I hope you're awesome. And, you know, but that goes a long way in the freelance world. You know, I don't have to do that. And I just think it's about community. It's not always about like paychecks and things like that. So
for sure. For sure. Well, and you know what people don't really realize is, you know, those relationships that, you know, that 20 seconds of texting someone or calling them for a couple minutes, checking in, you know, if you want to relate it to business, there's a freelancer that, let's just put a number on it, at $50 an hour, that freelancer is making you $300 an hour that you're billing. Right. So it's interesting to kind of take that approach of like, hey, build something with people that they're going to make what they make. And then you add on to that and you make what you make. So you create a real business.
You know, you'll find out who people are team players or not. So there's another freelancer, right, I've had to let go of just like this week because something happened and I needed them to do, you know, just like step up a little bit and be my partner for a second, instead of just in production mode. And she didn't want to do it. You know, she's like, you know, it's, she went into cost mode versus like partnering mode of conversion. And so, you know, okay, got it. You know, you're not going to be able to be a partner in this. One of the challenges I think freelancers have is they go into that hourly versus understanding partnership around a business, that if you can partner with a business owner like myself, who's, I consider myself in the world of wealth dynamics, a star creator, who's in the front line. If you can partner with someone like me, we take care of our freelancers because we know we can't do it. So without them, I just think that that's part of business is partnership. And I will say this, you know, I've had many successes in business, but I've had also fallen on my face. I lost everything in 2009 down to lived in my car with my dog, with nothing. And how I treated business before that was I was pretty damn demanding. I was very like grouchy and demanding and stuff like that. I didn't understand that what business really is community, and it's collaboration over everything. I had to have that lesson pretty damn hard. If you don't, that's to me, it doesn't matter what I'm creating, as long as there's co-creation and collaboration, then it's a win, right? And the moment that it gets into demanding and do what I say, it never works, right? I had to learn that lesson for sure. So, because no one taught me leadership skills. You know, you can learn marketing all day long, you can learn sales all day long, but if you don't know leadership, I think that's the biggest crux of business right now. So that's what I think.
No, I love it. I think, you know, that's a big, 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 big word called leadership, right? And how you own it and the way that you treat the people that are either freelancers, subcontractors, vendors, you know, clients. So we'll land on that one, right? You've obviously served hundreds of thousands of individuals and businesses. What are some of the things that you can share? And we typically end with this, but we'll kind of have a little bit of an insight here. What are some of the journeys that your client takes with you?
I'm going to generalize for a second. Clients, God, I've had so many different kind of clients. Sometimes I'm my own client, but as far as client work, most of my clients come to me because they already have the product and service and vision and they want to get more clients. That's like the typical generalizing. And one of the challenges they have, number one, is packaging themselves or their products or services. Number two, selling themselves. Self-promotion is a big one, right? How do you self-promote yourself? Like, how do you have the spotlight on yourself? It's very counterintuitive. If you look at how we're programmed, at age six, when you walk into the first grade, you know, what are you told? Sit down, do what the teacher says, raise your hand if you want to go to the bathroom. Like, you know what I mean? So in entrepreneur land, you have to be like, this is me. This is what I do. I'm amazing, you know? And you're not taught to do that. You're taught not to do that for pretty much 12 years of your life. Even if you are popular necessarily in high school, you're still taught like, you know, don't promote yourself or that's too much or whatever. So you have to be willing to allow yourself to self-promote yourself. This is who I am. This is what I do. These are my accolades. These are my awards. This is what I could do for you. It's very counterintuitive. That's like the number one thing I'm dealing with. Like I have a client right now. He's a top CEO of a company. And the company's, he's a new CEO. He's not the creator of it. It's been around for many years, like 30 years. So he's a newly elected CEO of the business. And so I'm working with him on his own personal self-promotion and self alignment inside the company as a leader, right? He's already CEO. He just got it recently, last couple of months. So now it's like, how does he position himself in the marketplace, i.e. his company inside of leadership, inside of his company? I'm working with him on that right now, his positioning inside the own company, even though he's already been titled the CEO. What kind of CEO is he going to become, right? What is he going to be known for inside that organization? So even at someone at his level is still dealing with his own voices in his own head. And is that pompous? You know, I don't want to be too much, you know, that's the number one thing. And then when you add a female side to that, females have even a harder time just because of society, things around. Growing up, no matter what, I grew up in a Baptist community. So there's that construct that you're dealing with. So I think the most challenging thing is self-promotion. That's the number one thing. Even though they come to me for something else, like he came to me for something else. He hired me for something completely different, right? But I always end up there. It's always the thing I always end up on is, how are you self-promoting yourself? What are you saying about yourself? What are they saying about you? How can we reposition you in that marketplace to go higher?
I love
every
it.
Time.
You know, there's a sequence of things that you do there, right? That I'd love to kind of go a little bit deeper on this specific subject. I think a lot of people could learn. What's kind of that first meeting agenda for you with any new opportunity or client?
Are they already a client or is it sales?
So brand new opportunity. So this gentleman came to you, like you said, for something else possibly, but then it kind of steered towards this. So is there a discovery call? Is there a needs analysis that you break down? Is there 15 questions that you go through? Like what is your process?
Oh God. I don't know my process. That's a great question. That's not true. I do know it. You know, I do a lot of listening. The first thing I ask is like, where are you at now? And then where you want to go? So in the world of sales, because I was taught sales, selling nothing. Let me explain what that means. I remember when I first got into the information marketing business in 2001, and I made my first $12,000 sale. It wasn't my products. I was selling on behalf of someone else. And this guy gave me his credit card. And I remember walking over to the little merchant and like sliding it and going one, two, three, one, like how many zeros it was, you know? And then like 12 grand, I just bought a car, you know, like that's crazy. And then all I give him is like a piece of paper. That's like, oh, and here are all your seminars for the next year. That was the first time I kind of caught into people pay a large amounts of money. This is 2002, $12,000. For learning something on where they want to be, right? So it's all about the gap. I call it the gap analysis. So the first thing I always look at is like, where are you now? Where are you now? Where are you now? And I really have them clarify. And then I really move into like, okay, where do you want to go? Where do you want to go? And I keep keeping them in that space. Like, where do you want to be? Where do you want to be? And then I show the gap. Like I really get them in the pain of the gap. Here's the gap. Gap could be this big, could be this big. It could feel like this big. Gap could be only that big. And then I move into like, am I the bridge for you? You know, are my products and services the bridge for you to get from where you already, where you want to go? And ultimately that's all sales, right? That's all sales. That's political sales. You know, if you politics, if you vote for me, I promise to get you there. You know, like it's all sales. But when you're doing it from a perspective of you're the one, or you're transferring that over to you're the one, that is challenging, because what we want to do is oversell it, right? We want to get into this whole process and benefits and features. At the end of the day, people just want to feel like you got where they are, you got where they want to go, and you can help them move forward to this place. That's at the end of the day. That's my job, duty, responsibility. I think all sales is that.
No, thank you for going deeper. You know, that's an area I think on our channel, sometimes we miss in some of our interviews, but I love that that's really specific way of channeling. You know, you're here, Mr. or Mrs. Client, and could be company client or whoever, right? Yeah. There's that gap. And do you fulfill that? That's a pretty awesome way to really break it down.
Let me go a little step further, if you don't mind, because I think it would serve this particular listener. Okay. So that always wasn't clear to me. Let me explain. So how I got my first, I keep saying this business because it's really the information marketing speaking business. And I got thrown into it in 2001. I was traveling the country. And so I want to get you the scenario for a second. So my job was to get on a plane on Sunday, go to some city in the United States, and then walk into 6 events in 3 days. And we didn't know who's going to show up because it was a free event. And then our job was to pretty much extract $3,000 out of as many people as possible. That was our job. $3,000 for a seminar that wouldn't even come for another 2 weeks. Okay. Now, we were going to a place like Peoria, Illinois, like exactly exciting places. Okay. And then my counterparts, their other teams, they were going to like New York and Denver. And we either ate ramen noodles that night or Ruth Chris, right? Based on what we could extract. It was like die or live great every day. And so I asked my, you know, counterparts, I said, why is it these guys are going to Denver and the same amount of time of 3 days, they're seeing 500 people and we're seeing like 30. It, no matter how you swing it, like they're going to make more money, right? Because we're seeing more people. And they go, well, their percentage of closing's higher. And I'm like, well, how do we get our percentage closer? We're all selling the same thing. We all have the same presentation. We all have the same thing. And they go, well, you know, you got to figure that out. So I became what I call, I call it a seminar whore. I went to every front end seminar, Tony Robbins, Robert Allen, Zig Ziglar, all of them. I sat in the front seat and I was take notes on why is it people were running to the back of the room on like Robert Allen. And then the next speaker would come and it was like crickets, right? And then like another guy would come up like running the back and another guy's like, what was the difference? Was it just their charisma? Was it what they're wearing? You know what I mean? Like, what was it? So I would take all these notes and then I'd bring them back to our speaker. We were like a team environment and he would tweak and we'd tweak and we would, you know, be a team. And next thing you know, our numbers were going up. And that's when I learned that. That's when I learned that, you know, at the end of the day, you're dealing with a human being. At the end of the day, they have desires and dreams. And it is a combination of positioning, what you say, how you say it, and can they feel confident that they hand over money, that you're going to get them to where they want to go, period, right? So then we started going to places like New York and LA and Denver and like making more money. It was great. But that's where I learned that from. It was, you know, 7 years on the road like that. Living on the road day in, day out, 50 weeks out of the year, looking at people's eyes and them saying no or tears saying yes. I mean, I learned that from 7 years of on the road.
That's interesting, you know, and what a different type of business, right? Learning how to really kind of get into the mental psyche of people and why they attended your free seminar. And then you having to be, you know, they don't know you from Adam, build the rapport instantly, build that trust, and then say to them, hey, look, you know, I've got the tools and the way for you to get from A to B. So really, really cool thing.
Just to complete that for you, in 90 minutes, we went from stranger to 90 minutes that, you know, them handing over $3,000 in 90 minutes and no like and trust factor had to be really fast. So
that's incredible. So, So look, I mean, obviously, you know, Sexy Boss Inc. is thriving and you're doing some great things. So we like to always end our interviews with what's called CEO, right? So the Go for CEO channel. C is for client experience. E is for employee engagement. And in your case with freelancers, I mean, basically subcontractors, people that, you know, they have to do business with you, but how do you make them feel? How do you engage with them? And then O is for operational excellence. So why don't we break down those for about 30 seconds to maybe a minute and a half of what do you feel is the really the value proposition of Sexy Boss Inc. When the client walks in, what is their client experience going to be?
Yeah. Okay. Got it. So client experience is they have someone in their corner and they have someone that supports them in their vision and where they want to go. It's not my job doing responsibility to create their dreams, right? It's their dreams. My job is to support them in creating those dreams. That's truly the client experience, period.
Awesome. And then employee engagement, when you think about these freelancers, you kind of talked about it a little bit, like you're willing to make that text. You're willing to send maybe a flower. Maybe you're willing to spend 5 minutes on the phone with someone having an issues. But what do you think it is that really people are attracted to do business with you as a vendor, freelancer, those types of things when you think about you and your leadership?
The number one thing that I do really well, they sometimes tell me what their services are, like this is what I do. But I always kind of go deeper, and just because someone says this is what they do doesn't mean that's what they're best at, right? And so sometimes I dive in deeper and I realize what they're really good at. Like I've had a freelancer that they say, well, I could do project management. I'm like, nah, but I want someone who like eats that up, like just freaks out on like detailed OCD stuff. And so what they're really actually great at is doing a specific kind of presentation, outlining stuff. So once I dived into their superpower, I'm like, I want to pay you for that. And they were kind of shocked because to them it was like easy. And so I always try to find out what they're really good at. Like what's their like, what do they just like geek out on so that I can then pay them for that. Most people don't do that. They just like, what's your services? What's your prices? And I try to figure out like geek out. And the other thing I do a lot, like this one client he's a freelancer who's in, who has COVID. I figured out what his packaging was And then I've sold that for him in some other places. Like, oh my God, I can totally connect you. And I connected with like five other people. And I got on like five clients. So, because he doesn't know how to sell himself. So yeah. I just said, well, do it for me. Okay. And then I'm going to sell you. And I got like five clients for him. And he was like, I love you. You know, those are kinds of things that most people wouldn't do, but why wouldn't I?
That's awesome. That's awesome. So, and the last one is operational excellence, right? Obviously you have to kind of spin a lot of plates. Maybe you're flying around. I know that we kind of did a pop-up today with your studio and everything that you're doing. So yeah. Tell us a little bit about like what kind of is that master level operational excellence that you have? Like, are there any tools that you use, any systems or anything that you could leave the audience with?
Tools. Okay. So I definitely use something called High Level. It has my funnels, my marketing, my email marketing, my text, everything inside of that. I have an agency with side of that. As far as project management, I'm not the best on that, but I use ClickUp. And I keep things pretty streamlined, believe it or not, in the world of that. And I have an assistant. And the reason I don't have what I call a fat around that, because I think that you want to creep things streamlined as much as you possibly can. And there was a point in my life that I had a big payroll and I felt like I was, I worked for them, you know, like my job was to make enough money so they got paid. And I didn't like that feeling. So I prefer to keep things really simple and really streamlined and to keep people in their wheelhouse as much as they possibly can and to keep them fed. And just be feeding them, feeding people, feeding freelancers, operations. You can feed them by obviously paying them, which I do, but I also feed them in other ways, right? I feed them in ways of other clients and giving them the spotlight and serving them and helping them in other ways. So in the world of operations, I don't know, I've come full circle into a point where I want to empower more people to step up into their greatness. Now, I know in the world of scaling, you know, I need to completely readjust and have more people on my payroll for this next level. And I will, but that's just where I'm at right now.
No, and you know what, and you've kind of learned where you want to be and some of the comfort levels, not of comfort in the sense of stagnicity, right? Being stagnant, but comfort of knowing how you operate at an excellent level. So pretty darn awesome. Really cool to hear. And here's the thing with Gopher CEO, we'd love to have you back in the next 6 to 12 months, hear about maybe some of those scaling things that you're going to be going through, some of those growth opportunities that you're going to be going through. But, you know, so that's one of our missions is really to build a tribe behind Heather Havenswood and Sexy Boss. And hopefully by the third or fourth interview that we have with you, there's like this tribe of people just waiting to have Heather back onto the Gopher CEO community. And that's one of the things that we are looking to really build. So Heather,
if you mind for just a second, I'd love to share about my upcoming book, if you're okay.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I was just going to say like, what is the next thing that's going on? And then number two, how can people communicate with you and reach out to you, website, those types of things before we end here?
Awesome. Thank you. So the best way to get a hold of me right now, I used to say my website, but really it's Instagram. And I know that's counterintuitive for maybe CEOs, but I'm finding that the relationships I have inside the DMs of Instagram and on Clubhouse is really incredible. So if you message me if you follow me on Instagram, which is Heather Havenswood, I'm the only one, Heather Havenswood, and you follow me and then click the message button and DM me the word podcast, what's going to happen is you'll see my bot, but that's kind of you raising your hand, very interested, or just tell me that you're listening to me on John's show. And then I would love to have a conversation. The reason I say that versus like opting in is that DM is an engagement. Like you and I have been back and forth, right? So that to me is true engagement and relationship building. But I'm coming up with a book. I've been working on it for a year. I just got signed by my second publisher. And I say that because the first publisher is definitely a large publisher, New York Times bestselling publisher, but we parted ways because I cuss in the book and because like that's how I talk. And my whole book is called Uncage Yourself. And I'm all about uncaging and unleashing your greatness. And they wanted me to cage my voice. And so I was like, I can't do that when my whole thing is about uncaging. So it's called Uncage Yourself. And it's the 7-step process that I've taken for all my businesses. Every single one of my businesses I've started from scratch, and 0 to 1 million, 0 to 1 million, 1.5, 12 months, 18 months, every single time. It's the same process. So I finally kind of laid out the methodology. It's called Uncage Yourself. And it's about truly unleashing and uncaging your greatness and your knowledge and building a business around it. So I'm excited about it. It's coming out. Everything works out, it'll end up being December of 2020. And I'm super excited about that. So the best place to get a hold of me is truly Instagram. But I would say, please check me out on Amazon. I got a lot of things going on Amazon. And of course, my podcast is across every single platform you can think of. Just type in Heather Havenswood. It's called Uncaged.
Yeah, no. So Heather Havenswood, H-E-A-T-H-E-R, everybody. Havenswood, H-A-V-E-N-W-O-O-D. So I love it. So, hey, Heather, thank you so much for coming on to the Go for CEO community. Love to have you on in the next 6 to 12 months. Learn about that next journey, especially if that book's coming out, you know, soon at the end of this year. Excited to have you on and kind of talk about that. So let's build a tribe around sexy boss. I'm excited and so thankful for you to come on. So thank you so much. And we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you.